So now let's formalize our relationship between stress and strain. Or in this case, what we're going to do is make a relationship between the stress tensor and the strain tensor that we've already introduced. But just to review, here's our stress tensor here. So again, we represent the stress tensor as the three forces acting on the three faces of a cube. And recall that we don't really mean these forces are separated by any physical distance. We just use the cube as a convenient way to draw. Really, we're talking about all these things existing at a single point in space, so at the center of this cube. But we draw it this way for convenience. And remember, we have our three faces, X, Y, and Z face, which are the blue, green, and red forces here. And then we have the X, Y, and Z forces. So the rows are the faces, the columns are the direction of the forces. So therefore, we have nine components. But as we've written it here, we know that the stress tensor has to be symmetric in order for the sum of the moments to be zero. So these components are the same, these components are the same, and these components are the same. Sometimes we'll write the stress tensor rather than using the capital T notation, sigma along the diagonal to denote that those are normal stresses, right? So our normal stresses are the ones that act perpendicular to each face. And then our off-axis component are the shear. And again, by symmetry, there's really only six unique components, even though there's nine components in the tensor. E is our strain tensor, where we have the normal strains along the diagonal and the shear strains on the off diagonal. And our definition of the strain tensor has this funny factor of 1/2 that we'll get to in a minute. But that comes up from relating the strain tensor to the displacement gradient. So the strains are computed from the displacement gradient. And so the displacement field, remember, is a vector with components u, v, and w, x, y, and z components of the vector, which represent the vector that points from where a material point is in the initial configuration to where it moves to in the deformed configuration. And so when we take the gradient of this vector, we have three components of the vector, but we have three directions to take the derivative in. So we take the x, y, and z derivative of u, the x, y, and z derivative of v, the x, y, and z derivative of w. And when we define the strain tensor, we want it to also be symmetric, just like our stress tensor, which is why we add the gradient and its transpose together to form this strain tensor. Now, we should also point out or remind you that this strain tensor is not general, but really we should call this the infinitesimal strain tensor. So it's really only good in the limit that the strains are very small. So in more complicated configurations, this could be more complicated, but we're just gonna consider the infinitesimal strain tensor. So finally, going back to our little foam models, here's my cube, here's my three forces acting on this face. I have three forces acting on this face, three forces acting on this face. And just to remind ourselves why we use a tensor is because the direction of the force matters, right? So here I'm applying a force in the x direction, but I'm applying on the x face so it squishes. If I apply an x force on this face, it shears. And so again, the stress tensor, we need it. We need the tensor object because we have to depend not just the direction of the force, are we pushing this way or that way, but what face we're pushing on. And when we come back to our strain tensor, right, remember we have to have a way to capture the fact that we can have axial strain in three directions, so x, y, and then out of the page in z. Then we also have the shear, which we have three planes, right, this surface, and this surface, that we can have shear. So here I'm showing shear in the xy plane. The other ones would be out of the page, so a little difficult to show on the video. Okay, so now let's make a formal connection between our stress tensor and our strain tensor. And here I'm just putting dashes to remind ourselves these are not unique components. Okay, so you remember we had two relationships we wrote before. One was that the stress was proportional to the strain through Young's modulus. And when we talked about tension in a bar, we talked about normal stresses and normal strains. When we talked about shear, we said that the shear stress was proportional to the shear strain through another constant, G. So in this case, E is the elastic modulus or Young's modulus. In this case, G is the shear modulus. And we also proved that these two are not unique but related to each other through Poisson's ratio. So even though our linear elastic model has three constants, E, G, and nu, or Poisson's ratio, really only two of them are unique. Okay, so now let's think about these components in our relationships to write this these relationships in a more general way. So when we had tension in a bar, we said that the normal strain was equal to the normal stress divided by E. So just the inverse of this relationship. But if you recall, there was another effect as well, right? So when I apply a normal stress in the X direction, there is definitely a strain in the X direction because we see the bar deforming. But also remember, the bar gets skinnier. So a stress in this direction causes a strain in the Y and the Z direction. The bar gets thinner when I pull on it. And so the way we described this for us before was that there is the component of the strain due to the normal stress. So there's also a strain in the Y direction, which is the same as the strain in the Z direction, which is given as the Poisson's ratio times the stress in the X direction divided by E. So when I have a stress in this direction, it causes strain in the two transverse directions. So likewise, what that means is that if I have a general case where I have lots of different forces acting on the bar, right? So I have stresses in all directions, that there will be strain in the X direction, which is given as this same factor, Poisson's ratio over E, times the stress in the Y direction plus the stress in the Z direction. So the total strain in the axial direction, X direction, this component of the tensor is going to equal the sum of those two contributions. So we're left with a form like this. And so for convenience, and we'll see why we do this in a second, I can rewrite this in the following way. Where now I have a factor of 1 plus nu here, and I've added a sigma x here. So you see I haven't changed the equation because I've just added a factor of nu times sigma x minus nu times sigma x. But the reason is that now we have this same relationship for the strain in the x, y, and z direction, and all I have to do is replace it by the normal stress in the x, y, and z direction. And all of them will have this same kind of factor here. So this is kind of interesting too, because I can write this in one final way using g. So now I can write my formula with g in here. And then each component, again, x, y, and z, we would just replace x, y, and z there. But they would all have this term here, which is just summing the normal stresses along the diagonal. This effect of summing the terms on the diagonal is something that's called the trace. It's an operation you might be familiar with from in linear algebra called the trace, where we take the trace of a matrix, or in this case, the tensor, and we just sum those three components. Now I have a relationship between the normal strains and the normal stresses, but now let's go over and look at the shear. So our relationship for the shear stresses would be that the shear strain is equal to the shear stress divided by G. However, we see that in our strain matrix, there's this factor of 1/2. So if I said the EXY, so this component of this tensor, is equal to 1/2 the shear strain XY, so gamma XY, which is equal to shear strain XY divided by 2 times G, right? So now we're sort of seeing this common factor of 2G here. Here's our final relationship, which tells us that the strain tensor is the stress tensor divided by 2g minus subtracting this factor that's proportional to the trace of the stress tensor as well. This notation here, I with two underlined lines, is just the identity matrix. So the identity matrix is nothing more than 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay, great. Now let's summarize these results in our final formulation. So at this point, believe it or not, we actually have enough information to close the problem. And so here it is summarized on one sheet. So let's walk through everything so we remember where it came from. So first of all, we have three partial differential equations, which are stated up here. And here we've written it out as three components, so x, y, and z components. And these equations basically represent the sum of the forces equal to zero. And it gives us a relationship for the partial derivatives of the components of the stress tensor. So here we have the normal stresses in the x, y, and z, and then we have the shear stresses in the different planes. And so this is our representation of sum of the forces equals to zero. So we use sum of the moments equal to zero in the symmetry of this matrix. So we have tau xz, and here we have tau xz. In our original formulation, we had the xz and the zx components of the tensor, but our sum of the moments equal to zero give us symmetry. And I'm not going to go through it in this particular video, but we can write this in a more compact way with our vector calculus operations. So the way we would write these three equations compactly in vector calculus notation would be, so we would say the divergence of the stress tensor is equal to zero. Even if you've taken vector calculus at this point, you're probably not quite sure what the divergence of a tensor means, but in a later video, I'll walk you through kind of that. But for now, just know that we can write this in kind of a compact form. And then we have what we call our constitutive law, or Hooke's law. So Hooke's law relates the strain tensor to the stress tensor. And we call it a constitutive law because really it's an empirical law. And in this case, it's our linear elastic solid undergoing small deformations is what this law is good for. And we say it's a law, but it's not really a fundamental law. It's just how material behaves. So it's not something we derive from any kind of first principles, our knowledge of atoms, or anything like that. It just comes through some observations, and it's really thought to be, we can think of it really as an empirical law. So not all solids follow a linear elastic law. So here we're making a relationship between the strain and the stress. Some materials depend upon the strain rate, so how quickly something is sheared. So silly putty would be an example like that. Its behavior, if we sit it on the table, is very different than if we bounce it. So if you sit silly putty on the table, it just kind of oozes out and flows almost like a fluid. If we drop it, it bounces like a rubber ball. So we can have more complicated behavior. We're not going to consider any of that behavior in this course. And then finally, our infinitesimal strain tensor E is related to the gradient of the displacement vector. So this is really the thing that our formulation allows us to solve for, are the three components of the displacement vector, U, V, and W, right? And the displacement vector, again, is the vector that points from a material point in the original configuration to where that point ends up in a later configuration. So basically, if we sort of substitute everything in from bottom to top, we have three equations, 1, 2, 3, for three unknowns, which end up being U, V, and W. So where does the material move in the original state to the final state? Now, I played a little bit of a trick on you in that the constitutive law I've shown here says that stress is a function of the strain, whereas on the previous page, I said strain was a function of stress. But all I've done is invert the law. I've just skipped a few steps showing it to you. Now this is kind of complicated looking, and it actually is. And so it's very hard to solve these kind of general equations for general geometries and general loading. So usually for a general problem, we'll have to go to a computer to solve these problems. But in some later lectures, we'll go through some of our classic simplified cases of loading and deformation, and we will we'll show you how to solve this for the displacement vector in kind of a more formal way. But this is our formal expression of linear elasticity.